Our scripture reading today is Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." The devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered, "Do not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Here ends the reading.
Well, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. 20 years ago, I was working in the restaurant industry hosting wedding banquets. It makes me feel really old to say that. Like, I got a birthday coming up this week, and I wrote that and went, "Man, you're old." Not as old as some of you, so. So I'm working in the banquet. Okay, so I've totally lost you. I'm sorry. That was not scripted. So I'm working in this banquet facility hosting restaurants, and we're plating tremendous food, and we're serving fantastic drinks, and I get to cater to every whim and wish of the new bride and groom. It was a super fun and exciting way to work. It was a great atmosphere. I loved taking care of the new prince and princess. Anything that they would ask for, I could make happen. At the end of one evening, as I was training in to be a manager, I stood over a case of champagne, counting out the empty bottles that were to be charged to the bill. We had poured 13 bottles for the toast, but the contract had estimated 26. As I stood there writing up my tally, my mentor looked over my shoulder and coarsely asked, "Why don't you just charge them for 26 bottles?" And in absolute naivete, I said, "Because they only drank 13, I can't charge them for 26. I mean, I thought that was pretty clear. And he said to me, I'll never forget this, he said to me, "Just bill them for 26. That's the estimate, that's how it works, that's how everybody in the industry does it." And then he walked away. I'm like, really? So everybody in the industry does it? I mean, it felt like stealing. So I wrote up the bill and I presented it to the bride and groom, and I came back with the check and I handed him the receipt with all of the food and all of the wine and all of the service charges totaled up, including 13 bottles of champagne. And he was not pleased. Needless to say, I didn't last long working under him, but more importantly, I found out he didn't last long in the industry. You have to fight temptation. We all face temptation, but you have to fight temptation because we find ourselves making these little decisions often, everyday decisions about what we do or what we say or how we behave. And we face those at work and at school and in our family and even on social media. And those decisions, how we make those decisions, how we come to those conclusions, are based off of an intrinsic understanding of who we are, our identity. And most of the time, those decisions aren't all that hard, but every now and again, we're faced with a decision to say or to do something that doesn't align with who we are. And those temptations, those tests of our character can undermine our integrity and eventually change our identity if we fail to fight them. We're continuing our series through the Gospel of Luke, and we find ourselves already in chapter 4, which seems really quick since we just started this at the beginning of December. But if you have your Bible with you, I'd like you to open that. You're looking for Luke 4. If you're using the Pew Bible, hopefully somebody has stuffed a bookmark in there so it's easy for you to find. If not, it's on page 717. Just do the next guy a favor and stuff a bookmark in there for them to find. Let's just make it easy for everybody. Luke 4. Luke 3 ends with John the Baptist standing on the edge of the Jordan River calling people to repentance. Does anybody remember the word we used for repentance last week? A Greek word. Gold star, Karen Adamski. Well done. Metanoia, we covered that last week. But then Jesus, from there, steps into the water and is baptized with everyone else. Luke concludes that chapter by listing 75 generations of names. If you look back above to the end of chapter 3, he lists 75 generations of names, which I intentionally skipped over this morning, not because they're unimportant, but because Lisa said she would go on strike if I made her stumble through all of those names. No, actually, she didn't say that, but it would be a train wreck. Like, try to read those without fumbling out loud. But Luke's point is this. As Jesus is baptized, and heaven opens and the Holy Spirit descends in the form of a dove, God's voice confirms his identity. God's voice confirms, he says, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." That is your identity, Jesus. You are the Son of God. And then Luke traces Jesus' family tree, starting with Joseph. All the way back, Joseph, who is the son of, all the way back to King David, back through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, all the way back to Noah and the ark, and to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And finally, Luke finishes by writing, "Who is the Son of God." This is your identity, Jesus, traced all the way back. You are the Son of God. And so we arrive at the beginning of chapter 4, verse 1. Now Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry. Yes, 40 days without food. Thank you very much, Luke. That's obvious. Hungry. Maybe even hangry. But as obvious as that is, sit with that description for just a moment. Sit with that explanation because I think what it does is give us a lot of insight into how temptation comes. First of all, temptation comes when we're strong. Even Jesus being filled with the Holy Spirit, Jesus being led by the Holy Spirit is tempted, which is a good reminder to us that even the strongest Christians, the most faithful Christians, the most Spirit-filled followers of Jesus will and can be tempted. We have to stay on point. We have to stay alert and pay attention to temptations, even when we feel spiritually strong. Like when your prayer life is dialed in and your worship experience is hitting on all cylinders, both the Apostle Paul and the Apostle Peter say, if you think you're standing firm, be careful. You do not fall. Be on your guard. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him. It's important to note, temptation isn't just for the weak in faith. It certainly comes to the strong. Jesus was tempted. Secondly, temptation comes when we're alone. Jesus was alone. Jesus went into the wilderness alone. It's often when we are alone, when we're feeling lonely, that we are vulnerable to temptation. When we feel like no one else is watching, when no one else is around, when we feel disconnected or invisible, when we don't have accountability or support around us, the devil sees an opening. Being alone or feeling lonely can open the door to temptation. Thirdly, we can also see that temptation comes when we're in unfamiliar territory. Jesus was in the wilderness, which is by definition unfamiliar territory. Being in unfamiliar circumstances and settings is a tense and hard place to be. When we get into scary or strange situations, we often feel like it's a place that we have to sink or swim. We got to just make it happen. We just got to do it. When we're in strange situations, it's a new job. It's a new relationship. It's a new season of life. All those things can be overwhelming, and the urge to either please or fit in or conform can cause us to bend and to flex our identity. Temptation comes when we find ourselves in unfamiliar territory. One of the schemes we don't always recognize is that temptation comes after high praise. Jesus had just stepped out of the water. God had just said, "You are my beloved, you're my chosen, you're the one I love, you are the one I am highly pleased in." After all of those high accolades, immediately there the devil sets a trap. We see it all the time when we talk about people who got too big for their britches. They overplayed their hand. They got a little haughty. We're not surprised by moral and ethical failures of top CEOs, even high-profile pastors, church leaders. After high accolades, after you think you are on top of your game, when you're on top of the world, the guy who abuses that big promotion and goes way off track, or the Hollywood star who falls from the pedestal, we are susceptible to greater temptation when we think we're at the top of our game, when everything is going right. We have to be prepared and not fall for the temptation. And then, yes, temptation comes when we are hungry. When we're hungry, or when we're tired, or when we're frustrated or stressed, all of those, we make poor decisions. We say things we can't take back. We do things we regret. We slip into the path of least resistance, where if we were just a little bit more fortified, just a little bit more alert in the time, we wouldn't be so quick to look for the easy way out. But that's where the devil tempts us. So those situations, when we're alone, when we're in unfamiliar territory, right after we receive high praise, when we're hungry, even when we're strong, those situations are prime opportunities for the devil to take a shot at us. And now, that's probably not the most in vogue explanation to the modern ear, but there is a spiritual battle going on in the world. And the devil is going to take target practice on people. If you don't believe that, right? If you don't believe that there's a spiritual battle going on in the heavenlies over and against people, it's hard to watch the evening news and chalk it up to good people just choosing to do bad things, because there's some pretty horrific bad things going on out there. Now, if you don't believe that there's a spiritual battle being waged by a devil, then you have to conclude that people are in themselves evil. If there isn't a cause of evil beyond, then you have to believe people are evil themselves, that they simply decide to start pumping drugs into our community, that they simply decide on their own accord to orchestrate sex trafficking, to promote racism and sexism and commit genocide and spread terror all on their own. Otherwise, where does evil come from? It doesn't come from the individual. I have a hard time squaring the fact that evil exists in a world without a cause. On the other hand, you could conclude that there is a devil, that he does exist and is engaged in a battle against people who are created in God's image, and he has tempted some individuals to accomplish his ongoing war of destruction. The Bible certainly promotes the existence of a devil, of a fallen angel at war with God who has limited power to tempt his prey into wreaking havoc and death. And those are the battle lines that we see then coming together. We see those battle lines being drawn at the beginning of Luke chapter 4. Here's how it shapes up. This is verse 3. The devil said to Jesus, "If you are the Son of God," if you got a pen, I just want you to take and just stop right there, circle, underline, highlight the word if. If you are the Son of God. Because right there is the primary way temptation comes. He attacks our identity. If you are the Son of God. There's a sinister insertion of doubt. If you are the Son of God, you couldn't possibly be hungry. You couldn't possibly be facing this hardship if you were a child of God. You couldn't possibly be going through foreclosure or unfair work practices or infertility or cancer or facing a future without a spouse if you were a child of God. And all of a sudden we're left wondering, well, am I then? Am I a child of God? Like, will God take care of me? Am I really a beloved of the Lord? Am I really forgiven of my past? Am I actually promised abundant life when I'm facing this terminal diagnosis? Can I trust God as my Father in heaven? Listen, don't let the devil play the if game with you. And that's where he's going to start. Fight temptation. You are a child of God. God will provide for his children. Jesus fights temptation because he knows who he is and whose he is. He knows his identity as the Son of God, and he trusts God will provide for him. Because the first temptation is self-reliance. The devil says, if you are the Son of God, then make this stone to become bread. Of course, Jesus can do that. It's not a matter of if he can do that. He can do that. The story is told that he lifts up 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread and feeds 5,000 people. It's not a matter of if or if he can't. It's a matter of if he trusts his identity as the Son of God and relies on God to provide for him. The temptation is to get us to doubt our identity as the children of God. And if the devil can get us to doubt that, then the only choice we have is to be self-reliant. Like, if we're not a son of God, if God isn't going to take care of me, then I have to take care of myself. Then I have to provide for myself. Then I have to grab what I can get. Then I have to make life happen, to produce my own bread and become self-sufficient. And so we're tempted to force stones to become our next career opportunity. We're tempted to force stones to become our next income stream. We're tempted to force stones to become our next status symbol. Jesus doesn't have to create what he needs. He is a child of God, and he trusts his Father in heaven will provide for him. Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." Jesus is drawing out of this Old Testament scripture a truth that the children of God, the children of Israel wandering in the wilderness failed to learn. He quotes this scripture because the recurring question for the children of God, the children of Israel wandering in the wilderness, the recurring question that they had for Moses when they were hungry and when they were thirsty, when they had needs, was, is the Lord even with us or not? Do we have to do this on our own? But every time that God promised he would provide bread, it came down as manna from heaven. Every time he promised to produce meat, it came in as quails piled up. Every time he promised to provide water, it even sprung forth from a rock. God does not live by bread alone, by material things in the world, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God, which delivers the promises of God. Don't let the devil tempt you with the if. If you are a child of God, and God will provide. You don't have to be self-reliant. The second temptation is power. Verse 5, if you have it. The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want. If you worship me, it'll all be yours." You can have it all, right? You can have it all. You just have to sell your soul to the devil. You just have to worship him. And all of the power, all of the authority, all of the splendor, all of the fame and the fortune can be yours. Now, mind you, it only lasts for a few decades, but you will have forfeited an eternal kingdom. And in those few decades, you will be plowing people under and stepping on the weak. You will have to take advantage of the powerless and exploit folks around you to keep it. But evil has a way of doing that. And it's not just confined to those in political power. It's not just confined to those who are climbing the corporate ladder. We are faced with the choice to grab power every time we walk in the front door of our homes and look at our families. Because therein lies a huge temptation to grab power that is not ours. Because see, Jesus is not building a kingdom to dominate and subjugate the world. His kingdom is one that serves and blesses and frees those around him. And so Jesus is quite right in verse 8 when he says, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him," because you're going to serve someone. You're going to serve someone. We can serve God by serving others, or we can serve the evil one by serving ourselves and controlling others. But we're going to serve one or the other. So fight temptation and do not grab the power to lord over people. And now I want you to just recognize something as we work through this text, because every temptation the devil lays before Jesus thus far, he rejects by employing God's word. Jesus quotes the Bible. Jesus uses the truth about God clearly spelled out in the scriptures to refute the lies of the devil. There's one thing for you to take from the first two temptations of Jesus and apply it to your own life, is the importance of knowing and memorizing the scriptures. The Apostle Paul writes about spiritual warfare in the book of Ephesians chapter 6. You can write that at the bottom of your listening guide, Ephesians chapter 6. And Paul says, after you've put on all of the defensive gear of a soldier going into battle, the defensive gear of a soldier going into a spiritual battle even, we are to then take up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That is our one and only offensive weapon. The sword of the Spirit is the one and only offensive spiritual weapon to defeat the enemy, the Word of God. That's the only thing we can swing and wield and strike with. We have to know God's word and then employ it, swing it in the face of temptation. When you know God's word, you can counter the attack. That's why I tell you all the time, write in your Bibles, underline your Bibles, mark in the margin, circle stuff. Like, you have to learn how to use that sword. It's your only offensive weapon in the battle to fight temptation. You got to learn to use it. Because the third temptation is where the devil ups his game against Jesus. The third temptation is then to dictate to God. The devil sees what Jesus is doing by using the scripture. So he tries to use the Bible against Jesus by quoting it himself. And this is where it gets a little tricky, because the devil is tempting Jesus. What he's tempting Jesus to do is to demand God to perform. Right? If Jesus won't be self-sufficient, temptation one, and he won't grab power to serve himself, temptation two, then maybe he'll be tempted to demand God to provide for a need that Jesus isn't going to do for himself, and show up in power which Jesus isn't going to grab for himself, and force God to do it, to prove it. Prove God can keep the promises you say God can keep. Dictate to God. And Psalm 91 clearly says, the devil quotes it in verse 10, God will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. So jump. Here we are, we're at the top of the temple. Put them to the test. Make God keep his promises and jump. See how it works. You've seen the movie Aladdin? Yeah? This is God as a genie, and you and I as the master. Rub the lamp, open the Bible, pick a wish, grab a verse, and make the all-powerful God perform. And so many people fall into this temptation. We fall into this temptation. We put ourselves in terrible predicaments, in precarious situations. Like, we live way beyond our means. We do things that we know will ruin our health. We betray our spouse. We get up right up to the edge, and then we jump and we say, now God, pay my rent. God, heal my body. Save my marriage. And when God doesn't, we kick the lamp and we throw the Bible and we say, see, it's all hogwash. He doesn't do what he says he's going to do. I jumped off the cliff and God didn't do anything. God's not a genie. He does not serve us. He's not a wish granter. He's certainly not the one who cures stupid. Jesus says, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Like, fight temptation. Being intentionally foolish does not demand God will be our safety net. We do not dictate to God. Verse 13, when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left Jesus until an opportune time. He left Jesus until an opportune time. Here's the reality. Temptation comes back. Temptation comes back. It did for Jesus, and it will for us. The devil will retreat, but he won't quit. In all four Gospels, the story is told about Jesus feeding people with, he feeds 5,000 people with two fish and five loaves of bread. And what is the scenario? They're out in the wilderness. They're in the wilderness of Galilee. Everyone's hungry. Jesus looks up to heaven and God sends power to serve these people, and it happens. And the people go nuts. They love it. They love him. And Jesus receives high accolades, high praise, and there it is. The scenario is ripe. They're in the wilderness, they're hungry, there's power, and the man at the center receives high praise. So much so that the writer of the Gospel of John finishes the story by saying the people come to make Jesus king by force. And the temptation is back. You have to fight temptation. They're going to take him and say, make this world's power yours. We'll give it to you. You can be our king. But Jesus doesn't bite. Again, just before the crucifixion, an opportune time, Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's unfamiliar territory, and he's all alone. Everyone else is sleeping. Jesus is not looking forward to suffering. He is not excited about dying. And he prays, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. And the temptation is back to step out of what God has called him to do. The temptation is back to step away from him being Messiah, living into his identity. He's looking temptation straight in the eye, and he says, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He says, yet not my will, but your will be done. He's not going to bite. He's going to fight. Temptation comes back for each of us in the opportune time. The devil knows when to fight the battle. When we're alone, when we're in unfamiliar territory, when we're hungry, when we're dangerously close to grabbing power to serve ourselves. And that's where we have to fight temptation. Not my will, but your will be done. And when we know God's word, we know God's will. He will give us his grace to win those battles when we cling to our identity as the children of God. He will give us his grace to win those battles when we rely on him and not ourselves. He will give us his grace to win those battles when we fight with the power he dictates and use his word to swing it as a sword. We have to fight temptation because when we win, listen to this, when we win, he says we will receive a crown of glory that will never fade away. And that's what I'm fighting for. It's time to win. Let's pray. Lord, we all face temptation. And it's hard and it's grueling, but Lord, I pray that we know that we can't even do it the way that Jesus did it, perfectly stepping out of every arrow shot, stepping out of the way of every swing taken. He's not taken down by temptation, Lord, but so many times we get taken down. We're thankful that you've sent a Messiah to die in our place for our sins, that temptation, that the sin that comes after temptation would be wiped away. But Lord, we pray that you would teach us to use your word to fight the battle, that we would not bend to temptation every time it comes. Lord, strengthen us, empower us. Make us more like Jesus, and that this message would give us insight, eyes open, and even tactics to win the battle, because you've won the war. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.